Hi everyone, today we are going to start a brand new session regarding head and neck cancers. What are head and neck cancers? These are the cancers that arise any region from the base of the skull to the lower part of the neck. The most common cancers are oral cancers, throat cancers, esophageal cancers, thyroid cancers, and cancers of salivary glands. In the following videos, we will be discussing regarding individual subsites and their cancers in head and neck region. You want to know what are oral cancers? It's also called as mouth cancer. Mouth cancers have the highest incidence in India. The most important risk factor for developing oral cancer in India is primarily tobacco use, either smoking or chewing, especially in northeastern states where there is chewing of areca nuts also leads to cancers of oral cavity and other head and neck tumors. Alcohol consumption compounds the use of tobacco use and increases the risk twice. Exposure to UV radiation can also cause lip cancer in some individuals. Other risk factors include diet, family history, immune suppression, and chronic irritation. So to protect yourself, quit smoking today, reduction in your alcohol consumption, maintain good oral hygiene, eat a balanced diet, use sunscreen for protection from UV light, and definitely get checked up from your doctor regularly. You want to know the symptoms of a mouth cancer? The mouth is divided into many subsites like lips, tongue, floor of the mouth, cheeks, and retromolar trigone area. Each subsite produces different symptoms. On the lips, there may be ulcers. Any growth in the mouth will be generally painless, easily bleeds on touch. There can be loosening of teeth. There can be change of speech if there is a growth on your tongue. All of them are rarely associated with pain, or you may develop swellings in the neck called as secondary lymphadenopathy. There can also be weight loss or symptoms produced due to metastasis, that is the spread of cancer from mouth to other parts of the body. You want to know how oral cancer is diagnosed? Physical examination is the key. The doctor examines your mouth, sees the lesion, takes a biopsy, that is a piece from it, and the pathologist confirms the diagnosis. Followed by this, he goes for an imaging. PET scan is the most commonly used and advisable. It not only gives the location of the disease, extent, but also scans your entire body to see if the cancer has spread to other parts of your body. In some cases, like tongue, we also do MRI to get more accurate picture. In some cases, we also do FNAC, fine needle aspiration cytology, from the neck nodes to confirm the diagnosis when we are unable to take a biopsy from the primary site. For advanced studies, we can also study tumor markers from their blood. With the help of all these investigations, and then the cancer is diagnosed and staged with the help of imaging too. Do you want to know the treatment options for oral cancer? Surgery remains the primary modality of treatment for oral cancer. The surgery not only includes just the removal of the cancer, but also removal of the nodes that are swellings in the neck where the cancer has metastasized. Following the removal of the cancer, the residual defect will be reconstructed with the help of either a pedicle local flaps or a distant free flaps, which we will be discussing in detail. The other treatments include radiotherapy and chemotherapy, or in combination of both. The newer modalities which are coming up are immunotherapy and targeted chemotherapy. In this video, we will discuss in detail the surgical aspect in oral cancer. The surgery generally includes removal of a part of the cancer that is involved along with 1 cm margin around it. This is called surgical clearance. This step is done to ensure that the entire tumor along with its hidden parts or occult spread of the tumor will also be removed in one go, so as to reduce the chance of recurrence. The part that is removed depends upon the site of the cancer. If it's involved on the tongue, a part of the tongue can be taken, which is either partial or hemiglossectomy. If it's involved in the cheek region, we will remove the entirety of the mucosa that's involved, along with the other involved part like the lower jawbone or upper jawbone, when the cancer has spread into that bones. In some circumstances, we may also remove the skin overlying it when there is infiltration of the skin, or any structures that are directly involved by a tumor like the nerves or blood vessels.
In some extensive diseases, the resection or removal will either not only the primary location of the tumor as well as the adjacent sites. Like if a cancer of the cheek is going down and involving the jaw as well as involving the floor of the mouth, we will try to remove both the cheek, the jaw and the floor of the mouth as well as any important structure that are adherent to the tumors, like the submandibular salivary gland or the nerves surrounding the gland.
What are neck nodes? These are part of a lymphatic channel in the body which are useful to drain all the waste material or toxic material present or developed in various parts of your body to drain them out of the system. Generally, the oral cancers tend to spread through this same system and they get accumulated in one of the collecting parts that's called node, and they increase in size, finally leading to secondary neck nodes or metastatic neck nodes. Assessment of neck nodes is extremely important because 1. They help in understanding the nature of the disease. 2. They help in staging of the disease. 3. They also help in surgery as well as planning of the adjuvant treatment. The assessment is generally done via the help of a imaging, most commonly used PET scan. In some scenarios, there can be complete absence of the primary tumor anywhere in the body, but there can be only neck nodes. That condition is also known as MUO or metastasis of unknown origin. Important part of the cancer surgery is not just the removal of cancer as well as neck nodes. The reconstruction of the defect is also an extremely important and crucial part of oral cancer surgery. The reconstruction is nothing but the defect needs to be repaired so that the patient can have the structural integrity same as before the surgery, as well as the functions of the resected organ are restored to the maximum extent possible. That can be done via multiple ways, either local reconstruction with the help of flaps, which can be either pedicled or a free flap. What are flaps in head and neck surgery? It is nothing but a part of your body which can involve the skin, the muscles around it, or sometimes the bone around it also, to take from one part and bring to the defective area following cancer surgery and reconstruct them so that the complete function as well as structural integrity is restored. In head and neck region, local flaps or pedicle flaps are most commonly used, like a forehead flap or a flap from your neck area, and most commonly used flap like PMMC or pectoralis major myocutaneous flap from your chest region to reconstruct the defect. In the next video, we will talk about free flaps. A free flap is nothing but a tissue along with the skin, muscles and bone from far away from the site of the defect, like in the mouth, will be brought from the other region to the mouth and reconstructed in the defect along with joining of the bed vessels, so that this will continue as a living tissue like how it was previously from where it is harvested. One of the most common flaps used are radial forearm flap or the flap from your hand to reconstruct soft tissues like your tongue or sometimes the cheek regions. The other flap is fibula flap, that is one of the bone in your leg along with the skin and muscle and blood vessels are bought to reconstruct either the lower or sometimes the upper jaw with the help of it. The crucial part in this surgery is the anastomosis of the blood vessels of the flap to the local vessels in your neck, so that the harvested flap continue to live as a living tissue in the recipient area. Prognosis surgery can be primarily classified into intra-op, post-operative and late sequelae. The intra-op complications generally include bleeding or difficulty in dissecting or complete excision of the tumor. These are generally dealt intraoperatively by the surgeon and taken care. Generally, a post-op complication is either due to the complexity of the surgery or any patient-related factors like his existing comorbidities, like sugar, hypertension, bleeding disorders, etc. And the late sequelae are generally because of the resection of the tumor, leading to either functional deficit or structural deficit, which has to be accepted by the patient. The surgeon generally advises and explains in detail regarding all the complications and outcomes of the surgery. Hence, we advise the patient
to evaluate all the options in front of him and take a proper decision. The adjuvant treatment includes radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or newer modality treatments like targeted therapy or immunotherapy. The radiotherapy is nothing but projecting or beaming an ionizing radiation onto the human body in an extremely controlled environment. Ionizing radiation is a kind of radiation that kills a rapidly multiplying cell that is nothing but cancer in our bodies. There are multiple types of ionizing radiation which can be given in multiple settings in specific doses which are tailor-made to the patient needs and requirements based upon his cancer and his stage. A chemotherapy is nothing but a toxic agent that can help in killing a rapidly dividing cell, which also enhances the effect of the radiotherapy. Most of the curative radiotherapies are given intravenously and are specifically tailor-made for that patient based upon his stage and type of cancer.
What is the survival rate of oral cancer?
It primarily depends upon the stage of the cancer, age of the patient, overall health of the patient, and the treatment given. It is generally considered the earlier the stage of the cancer, the better the outcomes are, and the younger patients generally do well. When the overall health of the patient is good without any comorbidities, the outcome of the treatment is generally good. And coming to the treatment part, the treatment given in a tertiary center with all the facilities available and all the modalities available in the same center, where there is a tumor board which discusses a tailor-made plan for the patient under treatment, generally tend to get good results and better outcome. Coming to how do we prevent an oral cancer? In our Indian subcontinent, avoiding smoking and alcohol is an important step, as India has the highest number of oral cancers because of smoking and alcohol. Getting HPV vaccinations against the oropharyngeal cancers gives a good immunity against the oropharyngeal cancer. Practicing a good oral hygiene and having a healthy balanced diet will also help. Generally, the Westerners also take good care from protecting from the suns, as they have high incidence of lip cancers as well as basal cell carcinomas of the skin. Knowing signs and symptoms of cancers is very helpful in detecting them early so that the treatment is given and full recovery is achieved.
Share and follow for more such content.